the team members, and I'm going to ask that each of you just give us your name, what you are either studying in school or hoping to study, or whatever, if you have a career in mind that you think would interest you, share that, as well as your role. So what is your role within League of Legends? That can give us a little bit of information before we get started. And then after that, of course, there will be a video. As many of you know, I always enjoy creating opening hype videos for you guys, which will feature your logos as well, with permission from Riot Games. So we're going to go ahead and get started. And we'll bring up the first team here. The intro should come after. The video should come after. All right, apparently we're doing the video first. We're going with it. Just a note, so the theme for this video was the word Genesis, the idea of the origin of eSports and having it start this year on this campus. So now we're gonna have our first team come up on stage. Yeah. Yeah, you can go, yeah, up and, no. Yeah, go around. We're working out the issues here. We'll figure it out.
I'm Thomas Ward. I am just doing general studies and I'm playing support.
I'm Christian Duke. I'm going for my EMT and I'm playing top lane.
I'm Chris Tease. I'm going for associates in digital design and I'm mid.
I'm Evan Johnson. I'm studying forestry engineering and I'm playing jungle today.
I'm Alex Satara, and I'm playing ADC, and I am going for my nursing degree.
Thank you, guys. All right, next team up. Yeah, that's all right. That's all right. That works. We'll figure it out.
I'm Jace Craig. I'm hoping to study chemical engineering, and I'm playing Phil.
I'm Mark Dean. I'm getting an Associate of Science in Computer Science, and I'm playing support.
I'm Jack Wilson. I'm planning to study graphic design, and I'll be playing ADC.
I'm Seth Grover. I'm grinding out that high school diploma, and I'll be playing mid.
I'm Zach Browning. I'm getting an ASOT transfer in computer science, and I'm playing jungle.
I'm Jeremy Trappold. I am getting my transfer degree with a focus on philosophy, and I will be playing top lane.
All right, and our third team.
My name is Ethan Fisher. I hope to get into computer technology of any kind, and I will be playing jungle.
I'm Michael Davidson. I'm hoping to study computer science, and I'm playing support.
I'm Kermit Gaston. I don't know what my educational plans are, but I'm winning top.
My name is Jack Kemphill. I plan to go into computer science, and I'm playing ADC.
I'm Kyle Parker, and I plan to go into programming, and I play mid.
All right, last but not least.
This way. This guys, we're switching it up again. It's now this way.
This way.
Guys.
We'll
never have to cross the stairs again. This is the only time.
I am Brendan Will, and I am planning on going into marine biology. I am the jungle.
I'm Shea Garcia, and I plan on going to programming, and I'm going mid.
I'm Ezra Kofer. I'm planning on going into the infantry in the Marine Corps after high school, and I'm playing ADC.
I'm Wyatt Hughes. Plans are overrated, and I'm playing support.
My name is Alexander Sittis. I plan on coming here to OCCI, and I am top.
Okay, where's going?
We'll figure it out eventually. So we can get a big round of applause, please, for everybody that's here to play. Woo-hoo! And a thank you also to those in the audience that are just here to spectate. We really appreciate your support. So we're going to go ahead and get started. And we have our brackets set up for those that haven't seen them. So let's go ahead and let's get started. Yeah, so just a note, everybody, all the gamers, from now on, you're going to be going out that direction. Yeah, out the door, around the back. Okay, here we go.
All right, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Southwestern Oregon Community College. Normally, I'm the one who says home of Spiesel Court and Prosper Hall, but today we are in Empire Hall, home of the Hales Performing Arts Center, for our League of Legends tournament, and it's the Bandit Pandas. You're going to be first up against Legends Never Die. I, of course, am Jeff Baxter, and sitting next to me today...
I'm James Tubbs. I'll also be one of your commentators today.
And this is going to be quite a wonderful time here today. A first for me. Normally I'm the one commentating for your active sports, not your eSports. So this is going to be fun. Do you have any history playing League of Legends?
Yes, I do. I play the game quite a lot. Probably a little bit too much, but I do have extensive knowledge, I'd like to say, about the game.
Yeah, I've played for a few years, but I haven't actually played for like the past 2 years, so I might be a little behind the curve on the new changes that have happened. So as our teams are getting set up here, what strategies do you think they're going to be employing here today?
Well, I have seen both of these teams, not scrim together, but against other teams, so each of them will have, like, different strategies. I know for Team LND, they'll most likely be relying on their junglers for different types of ganks, and for Team Pandas, they have a more of a team-style game. I think their ADC is most likely their weak point, but we'll be able to see how they make up for that.
True. So that's not the only strategy they can employ, though. You don't want to be a one-trick pony as far as it goes with these teams. You want to have multiple strategies in mind to counter strategies that the opposing team might employ as well.
Yeah, Team LND also has different picks for the top laner. We know he mostly picks carry type of champions, so he most likely will be doing that again today. And for their bot lane, they mostly pick more of a supportive duo.
They're mostly passive in lane, so they mostly just farm up until they're ready for team fights.
Now, there's different stages for those who might not know of this game. There's the laning phase, then there's the team fight phase, and then that usually ends end game, is what comes after that.
Yeah, we got early, mid, and then late game. So we'll see what they base their compositions off of, if they'll be more aggressive in the early game, or more tactful in the mid game, or more heavy carry in the late game. Setting up right now and getting ready to get them into the game.
Yeah, so I'm wondering how well they're going to be chatting. It looks like all of them are getting some headsets on and going, and all of this lovely stuff has been donated by iBuyPower, if I remember correctly. They're the ones who are helping to sponsor this whole thing. So these gorgeous setups are way better than mine.
It's probably a little bit better than mine as well.
I did not know that you could actually create RAM chips that glowed until I saw that today.
Yeah, it's kind of fancy a little bit, but it also does have serious power behind it. So most of these players are going to be playing on computers that are a little bit better than their own. So the first game, they're probably definitely going to have nerves and trying to get used to the game. But after a couple of games, like probably on the second or at worst third game, they'll be ready and be able to play. So we probably won't see their best in the first game, but it should definitely be interesting to see what they're able to pull off.
You never know. Somebody could surprise you and then just all of a sudden go 12-0. As a mid laner.
That's the hope for them. That's the hope for their team.
We're just getting everything set up. This is the first time for us doing this whole thing, so there's a few kinks that we're going to have to iron out. And we'll have this up and running very smoothly shortly.
All the players are setting up, because with these new PCs, they also need to set up with their little, because each player has like different like preferences for what they want their mouse speeds and their certain keys they want them to be, so they're most likely going to spend some time trying to set that up. So
so you're talking about like your mouse scroll speed and potential key binds.
Yeah, I know for one their jungler for LND, he has his keys all over the place, but it's most comfortable for him. So it might take a little bit for him. And for me, I like to keep my mouse speed a little bit low so I have more control, like on where I'm gonna like shoot my skill shots and everything. So each player has their own different preferences. So we'll see what these players have of their own.
So we do have a featured team, and it is actually the team on stage left. So you'll be able to see them on stream right now.
And if I believe so, that is Team Panda Express.
I thought it was Bandit Pandas. Panda Express is a type of restaurant that has some really good orange chicken, but Bandit Pandas are the ones that are playing here today.
No, see, they're going to be the Express because they're going to be trying to bring in all the wins today on the train.
Yes, you got to board the Panda Express to win. Train. So there's the shots that you'll be able to see of what is actually going on the Bandit Pandas screens at this moment.
Be able to see everyone's different perspectives.
We're just setting up game here now, getting all of the players invited to the proper teams.
Make sure everything's all set up correctly.
So we'll be back after a brief commercial, and we'll hopefully have our tournament up and running.
This is Southwestern's Dental Assisting Program. In just one short year, you could be a dental assistant. Sign up now for your one-year dental assisting certification.
Tokyo Bistro, a blend of traditional and modern Japanese cuisine featuring fresh local seafood, seasonal produce, and unique wine and sake selections. Fresh, healthy, and delicious. It's truly a unique dining experience on Oregon's South Coast. Visit Tokyo Bistro.
Chase Berry for three. Rebound by Peyton Crispin. He's going to put it back. And
he got it.
The Lakers get a three.
Welcome back again. He's a perk on the Utah Lakers.
Can't get the shot to go. The Lakers win the ball game. Goal! Lakers win. Lakers win. Lakers win in overtime. 108-106.
Whatever your dream, just keep chasing it. In the all-new Honda CR-V. With available features like hands-free access power tailgate, turbocharged engine, and a sharper, more stylish interior. CR-V, the best-selling SUV in America. From Honda.
My name is Warrant Officer Candidate Brandon Morey, and I am a mechanic in the Pennsylvania Army National Guard. I work on Strikers, Humvees, 5-tons, work on the vehicles, fix the vehicles, get them back in the fight. My favorite thing about being a 91 Bravo is in the event that I would have to move on from the military, I would have a good skill set to help me along and utilize in the civilian sector.
HondaCertified.com, the easy way to search from thousands of vehicles.
Congratulations, you just got accepted into college. Now, how do you pay for it? Fortunately, there are several options out there to consider. Follow this simple step-by-step guide as you figure out how to pay for college. Step 1, fill out your FAFSA? Free Application for Federal Student Aid, FAFSA. Your FAFSA will determine if you qualify for financial aid, including grants, some scholarships, work study, and federal student loans. The good news is most people qualify for some financial aid, which is why this is the most important step in figuring out how to pay for college. Step 2. Figure out how much you may need to borrow by weighing your college costs versus your contributions, including any grants or scholarships. Some easy arithmetic will make your math teachers proud. Let's say your college of choice costs $30,000 a year after factoring in tuition, housing, books, lab fees, and a laptop. Now, let's pretend that the money found in your family swear jar, your bowling scholarship, your federal grant, and the money you saved as a scuba instructor contributes $10,000 to your college fund. Voila! This is how much you will need to cover through other means. Many families consider student loans a reliable option. Step 3. There are two categories of student loans you can consider, federal and private. Federal loans are made by the government and private loans are made by private lenders. In some cases, families use both to cover the cost of college. Compare student loan options by looking at their interest rates, repayment options, and fees. Interest rates vary depending on the loan type. Federal loan rates are fixed, while private loan rates can be fixed or variable and are determined by your credit quality. Adding a cosigner, like mom and dad, may help lower your interest rate. Repayment options for federal and private loans are also different. Some providers require in-school payments, some don't. Take a look at these now and choose an option that makes sense for you. Watch out for fees. Fees can be charged upfront or in repayment, and they add to the total cost of the loan, so you end up paying more back. Step 4. Factor in other benefits when researching a loan. Some reduce your interest rate and some give you cash back. For example, Discover student loans have no fees and give you a cash reward for a 3.0 GPA or equivalent. Let's go through these steps one more time, just in case you needed a refresher. Step 1, fill out your FAFSA. Step 2, weigh your school cost versus your contributions. Maximize any free money like personal savings, grants, and scholarships before considering loans. Step 3, compare interest rates, repayment options, and fees. Step 4, take into account any benefits the loan provider may offer. Don't forget that you can continue to reduce the amount you need to borrow with scholarships. If you are an eligible current or college-bound student, you can enter to win a $2,500 Discover Student Loan Scholarship Award. Head over to collegecover.com to learn more about paying for college and enter to win. No purchase or loan required. The first week of school can always be a bit overwhelming, but a little bit of good old college ingenuity can go a long way. Here are 10 collegiate quality hacks that will make campus life a little more comfortable.
Domino's delivery drivers are experts at handling bad roads. But those roads shouldn't ruin your pizza when you carry out. So we're doing something about them, starting with this one. If your drive home is rough on pizza, tell us at pavingforpizza.com so we can fix roads across the country. Then carry out large three-topping pizzas for $7.99 each.
Southwestern Oregon Community College gave me the opportunity for a new career doing something I love. I'm Amber Yardley, and 3 years ago, I knew I needed to make a career change for myself and my family. With the support of staff, my academic advisor, and the instructors at SWOCC, I now have a dream job and the confidence to continue my education. Contact Southwestern Oregon Community College and start the journey to your new career today.
I like how it's SWOCC.
Today we're opening more than 150,000 locations called Domino's Hotspots. Like beaches, roadside attractions, and dog parks! And you can finally have Domino's delivered to every single one of them. No address, no problem. Find a Domino's Hotspot near you. Excuse me.
get two medium, two topping pizzas delivered for $5.99 each.
Get the pizza you love delivered to a Domino's hotspot near you or any of the other outdoor locations now open for Domino's delivery.
My name is Rick Lopez. I'm the executive chef here at La Condesa in Austin, Texas.
I started when I was a young guy.
Plugging away, pushing, doing the hours, and it's kind of brought me here to where I am now. Hard work. My philosophy is work. Work and it'll happen. Always give your best because nobody can take that away from you.
Greatness is within reach. Right now you can get a great deal on the new Civic. KBB.com's overall best buy for 2016. From Honda.
Us further than our best.
Is it the competition?
Or a personal test?
Or perhaps it's a hybrid of both. Your best is always ahead.
Because better is a never-ending quest.
Introducing the all-new Accord Hybrid. Now, North American Car of the Year for 2018.
At Les Schwab, we give you extra without charging you extra. That means no hidden fees or unexpected costs, ever. Because when it comes to earning your business, we've got nothing to hide. Les Schwab Tires. Doing the right thing matters. It's summertime, the season to go to your go-to place. And no matter where that is, stop by Les Schwab for a free pre-trip safety check. You'll see why we're the go-to place for tires and brakes, no matter where you're headed. Les Schwab Tires. Doing the right thing matters.
I'm Private First Class Taylor Irwin, and I'm with the Maryland Army National Guard. I joined the Army National Guard to begin my career. So I have been awarded tuition assistance, and I picked furthering my education. Right now, we're just going through the basics. We're doing the confidence course. It's to get over your fears, basically, and to see how far your team has come. It takes a strong leader and strong drill sergeants as well. You're gonna meet some really cool people, and they're gonna help you get through it either way, so it's gonna be really fun.
No.
When you carry out, some things are out of your control. But with Domino's new carryout insurance, we'll replace your pizza if it gets ruined after you leave the store. Carry out large three-topping pizzas for $7.99 every day.
Every new Toyota comes with Toyota Care. It's our no-cost maintenance plan for 2 years or 25,000 miles. I wonder if we need more signs.
Toyota Care. It's no-cost maintenance for your Toyota. Toyota. Let's go places.
All right, welcome back, y'all. We're just having a little bit of network connectivity issues with one of the computers, so we're working to fix that, and as soon as that is done and fixed, we will actually come back and be ready with our tournament.
Yeah, we will get this all fixed up, and everything will be perfect.
This is Southwestern's dental assisting program. In just one short year, you could be a dental assistant. Sign up now for your one-year dental assisting certification.
Tokyo Bistro, a blend of traditional and modern Japanese cuisine featuring fresh local seafood, seasonal produce, and unique wine and sake selections. Fresh, healthy, and delicious. It's truly a unique dining experience on Oregon's South Coast. Visit Tokyo Bistro.
For three. Rebound by Peyton Crispin. He's going to put it back.
And oh, he got
it! The Lakers hit a three.
Welcome back again. He's in court on the Eurostock Lakers.
Can't get the shot to go, and the Lakers win the ball game. Go! Lakers win! Lakers win! Lakers win in overtime. 108-106.
Whatever your dream, just keep chasing it. In the all-new Honda CR-V. With available features like hands-free access power tailgate, turbocharged engine, and a sharper, more stylish interior. CR-V, the best-selling SUV in America. From Honda.
My name is Warrant Officer Candidate Brandon Morey, and I am a mechanic in the Pennsylvania Army National Guard. I work on strikers, Humvees, five tons, work on the vehicles, fix the vehicles, get them back in the fight. The fair thing about being a 91 Bravo is in the event that I would have to move on from the military, I would have a good skill set to help me along and utilize in the civilian sector.
HondaCertified.com, the easy way to search from thousands of vehicles. This thing from my hat to my shoes, yeah.
Congratulations, you just got accepted into college. Now, how do you pay for it? Fortunately, there are several options out there to consider. Follow this simple step-by-step guide as you figure out how to pay for college. Step 1. Fill out your FAFSA? Free application for federal student aid. FAFSA. Your FAFSA will determine if you qualify for financial aid, including grants, some scholarships, work study, and federal student loans. The good news is, most people qualify for some financial aid, which is why this is the most important step in figuring out how to pay for college. Step 2. Figure out how much you may need to borrow by weighing your college costs versus your contributions, including any grants or scholarships. Some easy arithmetic will make your math teachers proud. Let's say your college of choice costs $30,000 a year after factoring in tuition, housing, books, lab fees, and a laptop. Now, let's pretend that the money found in your family swear jar, your bowling scholarship, your federal grant, and the money you saved as a scuba instructor contributes $10,000 to your college fund. Voila! This is how much you will need to cover through other means. Many families consider student loans a reliable option. Step 3. There are two categories of student loans you can consider, federal and private. Federal loans are made by the government and private loans are made by private lenders. In some cases, families use both to cover the cost of college. Compare student loan options by looking at their interest rates, repayment options, and fees. Interest rates vary depending on the loan type. Federal loan rates are fixed, while private loan rates can be fixed or variable and are determined by your credit quality. Adding a cosigner, like mom and dad, may help lower your interest rate. Repayment options for federal and private loans are also different. Some providers require in-school payments, some don't. Take a look at these now and choose an option that makes sense for you. Watch out for fees. Fees can be charged upfront or in repayment, and they add to the total cost of the loan, so you end up paying more back. Step 4. Factor in other benefits when researching a loan. Some reduce your interest rate and some give you cash back. For example, Discover student loans have no fees and give you a cash reward for a 3.0 GPA or equivalent. Let's go through these steps one more time, just in case you needed a refresher. Step 1, fill out your FAFSA. Step 2, weigh your school cost versus your contributions. Maximize any free money like personal savings, grants, and scholarships before considering loans. Step 3, compare interest rates, repayment options, and fees. Step 4, take into account any benefits the loan provider may offer. Don't forget that you can continue to reduce the amount you need to borrow with scholarships. If you are an eligible current or college-bound student, you can enter to win a $2,500 Discover Student Loan Scholarship Award. Head over to collegecover.com.
All right, welcome back. We have everybody connected now. We were having a little bit of those network connectivity issues.
But we got that all settled out.
So we are ready to go here in just a short minute.
Yeah, we got all the players starting to get ready for the game. And we should be starting shortly.
That's not even a cuss word. It's put on. Is it the cuss word in there?
Are you talking? I can't hear anything. That's crazy. I can't see her. Oh, wait, you know what?
They'll tell you when to start.
he has the power to start because he's first on team one. That's why he has the ability to start game. I have 25%.
So we're just waiting.
Making sure all the players are getting ready.
Are we ready?
Yeah. Looks like everybody's in the game.
So,
but That's weird. We don't have the start game button highlighted.
We have a player who actually has the ability to start it. A technical difficulty, unfortunately.
As soon as everybody basically gives us a thumbs up, we're going to be ready to get underway. Looks like we lost one of our players.
Yeah, apparently one of the players does not actually have all the championships.
So it looks like one of our players is just changing their account as they needed a specific champion to be able to play this time around. So we'll be adding them in just a moment. So we'll take a short commercial break and be right back when we are all ready to go.
Congratulations, you just got accepted into college. Now, how do you pay for it? Fortunately, there are several options out there to consider. Follow this simple step-by-step guide as you figure out how to pay for college. Step one, fill out your FAFSA? Free application for federal student aid, FAFSA. Your FAFSA will determine if you qualify for financial aid, including grants, some scholarships, work study, and federal student loans. The good news is most people qualify for some financial aid, which is why this is the most important step in figuring out how to pay for college. Step two, figure out how much you may need to borrow by weighing your college costs versus your contributions, including any grants or scholarships. Some easy arithmetic will make your math teachers proud. Let's say your college of choice costs $30,000 a year after factoring in tuition, housing, books, lab fees, and a laptop. Now, let's pretend that the money found in your family swear jar, your bowling scholarship, your federal grant, and the money you saved as a scuba instructor contributes $10,000 to your college fund. Voila! This is how much you will need to cover through other means. Many families consider student loans a reliable option. Step three. There are two categories of student loans you can consider, federal and private. Federal loans are made by the government and private loans are made by private lenders. In some cases, families use both to cover the cost of college. Compare student loan options by looking at their interest rates, repayment options, and fees. Interest rates vary depending on the loan type. Federal loan rates are fixed, while private loan rates can be fixed or variable and are determined by your credit quality. Adding a cosigner, like mom and dad, may help lower your interest rate. Repayment options for federal and private loans are also different.
And now,
welcome back. So we are now currently looking at choices of banning. So this is where strategy starts to come into play. So it looks like, well, I'm wondering who's that first person was that just got banned. I don't know that champion off the top of my head, but it looks
that
like
that was Syndra. Right now, they're banning all the champions that they have an idea of what the enemy team will be playing. Mid lane has experience with playing Syndra, so they're quickly eliminating that pick.
Ooh, looks like Gnar getting eliminated as well.
We got Gnar and Talon being off the board already.
So when they ban, that means that nobody, no matter which team they're on, gets to play that.
Exactly.
It's like Silas getting banned.
Yeah, Silas is one of the newest champions. It's actually the newest champion to be added into League itself.
So that is what I'm not used to. That's where I'm like, who the heck is this guy? Because I have not played this for a couple of years. So it looks like they've added a couple of champions since my time.
Yeah, Silas is definitely a pretty strong choice. He has gotten some nerfs and some buffs. And for right now, it's a good thing they can probably ban them because LND, their jungler, has a lot of experience playing Silas.
Oh, what was that last one that just got banned? Was that Drake?
That was Darius.
Darius. Man, that has been a long time. His model has been updated since last I've seen him.
Yeah. His model's been updated, his kit has been updated from last time we played.
And Riven getting that final ban, so.
And now we're on to the picks.
So they take turns picking. First pick is going to the Pandas, it looks like. And then the next pick gets two. And then two after that, and then one. Is there an extra round of banning in these ones?
Normally there are an extra banning, but for this one we only have three at the moment, it looks like.
So the Bandit Pandas figuring out who their first champion is going to be.
I don't have all the champs either, though. I only have a good amount.
Wonder who it's going to be.
They're picking Olaf.
Ooh.
I'm wondering if, I think, yeah, this is what I was talking about with LND's top lane. There, he's most likely going to go for a carry top lane because he wants to be able to carry his team and be able to put out a lot of carry potential, basically.
That makes a lot of sense to me. It looks like Jax and Thresh.
So there, it looks like it might be Jax jungle, and they're picking their support already before the enemy team does that.
I always hated going against Jax.
Yeah, Jax is a very late game opportunity, like I was saying. It looks like they're already set up for late game, and we got Lux and Seraphon here, which are very heavy poke type champions.
I remember playing Lux. Lux was one of my favorite champions to play because of her really long ultimate. It basically went across the whole screen, it felt like.
Yeah, if she hits you with her root, which is her Q, and then following up with her ER, which is basically her full combo, she can pretty much eliminate any type of squishy on the enemy team.
Looks like we got a Nasus coming in and an Ahri.
Ahri? Yeah.
If I'm pronouncing things right, ooh, we got an Ashe getting counterpicked.
So far on the LND, they have a very heavy poke, and it seems like they have a balanced team. With their Xeroth and Lux, they'll be able to poke down the enemies. And with Kane is also one of the newer champions. Do you know who he is?
I actually don't know who Kane is. I know who Ashe is, though.
Yeah, Kane is actually a very special champion. He actually has a passive that lets him pick between two forms. It's called Red and Blue. It's really dependent on who he attacks. Like a melee user, he gets Red Essence, and he attacks a range user, it's Blue Essence. So from what I'm guessing, he's most likely aiming to be a Red in this game. Or if he gets really ahead, he's going to pick Blue, because Blue is known as Shadow, and Red's known as a Bruiser tanky build. They got Ashe for the slow, and they have Kate and Thresh is a very dominant bot lane, mostly. They can, if Thresh...
Now, Caitlyn's the one who's got traps, I remember right.
Yeah, Caitlyn's the one with her W. She lays down little traps. If Kate and Thresh are able to coordinate off each other well, they're able to... Basically, Thresh can pull into her traps, and she'd be able to get most of her damage off. Depending on what this Caitlyn wants to max, she can max her Q, which is her basic Q ability that she can use, or use her W, which is her traps.
Yeah, and with Ashe, you want to watch out for that cross-screen arrow.
Yeah.
Unless they change that ult.
Yeah, it's still global.
So you got to watch out, because she can snipe you from top lane to bot lane.
Yeah, if she gets that perfect ult off, and the stun increases to a maximum of 3 seconds, depending on how long it goes. And 3 seconds is actually a lot for League of Legends. Every second actually counts, because there's some stuns that only last for 0.5 seconds, but it feels like an eternity. So 3 seconds is an actual eternity in this game.
Yeah, and 3 seconds is more than enough time to actually get that kill when it comes to team fights. So you got to watch out. And that's where the engage is going to come from, is those little stuns, those opportunities. You're going to be looking for Lux to put down those shackles or Ashe to put down that arrow, and then the engage will happen after that.
Yeah, that's why I really like Lindy's team comp so far, because they have a lot of CC. They got Lux, Xeroth, and Ashe. Mostly on Lux, if she can land some really nice CC potentials, then they can absolutely destroy the enemy team. But enemy team does have some nice tank. They got Nasus, who is a heavy late game champ, but if they abuse him in top lane, he will be semi-useless. This ain't the nice words, but if he is able to survive and make it into the late game, he will be a monster to deal with, and that will be extremely hard to deal with, especially as an Ashe, because she can take down tanks pretty decently, but still, it's Nasus.
Yeah, you gotta watch out for both Nasus and Jax late game. Jax just becomes an absolute beast late game. As far as I've seen any interactions, we always would target Jax first. because if you didn't, you were going to get yourself destroyed by Jax.
The squishies are going to have to watch out for Jax, because he does have elite peek at basically closing the gap and basically just absolutely demolish the squishies. And the squishies are known as the Xerath, Lux, and Ashe, because they can potentially be one-shotted by Jax if he gets enough items. And then there's Ahri, who's also an assassin, who is going to most likely be targeting the squishies as well. Because if the LND has to really rely on their squishies, because if they lose them, they lose a lot of strength and power on trying to take out the other team.
Yeah, so one might call the squishies also glass cannons, where they can put out a lot of damage, but they can't take that damage. So you got to wonder if they're going to be implementing any kind of strategy. Are they going to be min-maxing, where they utilize the best of their abilities, or are they going to be adding some defense in there with their items?
Yeah, what they could do, like, there is Zhonya's. It's called Zhonya's Hourglass.
Hourglass gives you that 2.5 second invincibility.
Yeah. It's where that you basically just glow up radiant gold, and you can't be targeted by anything. But you do stand still, so if used wrongly, you can be put in a very bad position.
All right, so that's going to – the game is going to launch here in just a moment.
We got the delay over with. And we'll be jumping into the game. We got all the players loading up, and each – a nice thing about League of Legends, each – character on here has special skins you could acquire with RP. It's purely cosmetic and it doesn't really do anything in game, but it makes you feel nice.
Hence the Galactic Nasus and the Championship Thresh. Those aren't the default skins, nor is Odyssey Kane.
Or SKT1 Olaf, so apparently he's going to want to be Faker in this one.
We'll see what happens as we get loaded in here into this game. Because it looks like right now, I can see onto the stage, they're in laning phase right now, but we're not able to see that as of just yet.
Yeah, with the small delay that we get, we're going to be exactly just 2 minutes behind, 2.5 minutes, but we'll be able to get into the game and be able to see what's going on.
All right, so there we go. We're dropping into the game. And you got to wonder where these folks are going. I'm thinking that Nasus is going top lane.
We got the red team over here. Then all the way over here, we got the blue team getting ready to go to their respective lanes. It's really good when you're trying to get to your respective lanes. Like, we have what I call the five-lane defense, where everyone sets up in different areas. Like, we can set, like, a champion over here and over here to provide vision, is what I like to call it. And right now, we have Nasus already going top lane, so he's not really providing much vision, but he's at his lane already, so he's prepared for whatever.
Yeah, but you gotta look at everybody setting up in jungle. Looks like they're setting up around... Are they gonna do a blue buff invade, is what I'm wondering.
No, it doesn't exactly look like it, because we have bot lane, who seems to be pretty passive. It seems like they're gonna be... They're not worried about invades, but we got blue over here, who look like they want to do something. There's no wards in here, so they don't. Red team does not know they're in there. But Kane could go for their Raptors over here if he wished, and because his ability to clear jungle camps is very excellent. Like for Raptors, they mean nothing with his Q, because since he actually does bonus damage to creeps, so he could essentially take his enemy jungle's entire top half before he can do a full clear down here. And we have the minions coming in already, and we now have the laners now squaring off against each other. And we have the camps now being set up, and the laners giving respective leashes. But Kane, he's actually going for the invade, to where he doesn't want a leash. He's having his laners already get the lane a bit early, and he's going to be taking everything. But Red has this warded, so Jax now knows that he's at his red. So he could, Nasus could come and basically deal with that situation now, if he wished.
I don't think he's going to, though.
Yeah,
look like
it looks
he's
like
doing
he's mostly focused on stacking, because for Nasus, his main ability is his Q, to where he's going to be mostly focusing on stacking, because he gains bonus damage for every minion he kills. And it seems like we missed some action in the bot lane. It looks like Team LND got first blood on the Kate. It looks like they weren't able to apply their correct pressure, but like I said before, Lux was able to. They're the glass cans, like you said, they're able to apply, because Ashe has lost slows and Lux has a lost CC. So they're able to use that correctly.
Now, when you say CC, I assume you're meaning crowd control.
Exactly. That was the short term of it, but yes, it means crowd control. And Jax is doing the bot side still, and even though they had this ward here, they weren't able to stop Kane from taking his Raptors and his red buff. It looks like he most likely left his Scuttles. Not Scuttle.
The Wraiths?
The brains, most likely. The Krugs, that's the word.
Oh, the Golems.
The Golems, yes.
I know. I don't actually know about all of the names of the creeps and the minions that are out there in the jungles, so it's changed over.
Oh, looks like another kill in bot lane. Kate wasn't able to react fast enough, and she looks like she got CC'd by Lux.
So that's going to be those shackles. That's the Q, if I remember right. It's going to be holding the opponents down so they can't actually go anywhere. Mm-hmm. And it's only for like a blink of an eye, essentially, but that's enough to actually get that kill.
That's the thing. The longer you are held for, the more the enemy team can actually use that time to use their abilities on you, which could cause your death. We got Masses being up stacking. We got some action over here. Jax is able to jump. Oh, but Olaf flashed away. But Jax followed up with another flash, and Olaf might die just here. Yep. We got Jax got a nice, juicy kill.
You gotta watch out for those river ganks.
Yeah, so they didn't have any wards over here. It looked like Olaf was going over here to roam, or not roam, but be able to set up a nice ward right there, but Jax was able to meet him, and since Olaf was weak from battling Nasus, he was able to get a nice kill. And we have some action in bot lane still. Oh, looks like we just looked just in time, and
there goes Caitlyn again.
Yep, Team L. It looks like Caitlyn's just not having a good time at the moment, trying to deal with this pressure that Lux and Ashe are able to bring. Because Ashe is able to constantly slow, and her W does a lot of damage in a sense that she is able to constantly use it. And right here, we have a Scuttlecrab that Jax is grabbing. What Scuttlecrab actually does, it's actually a unique creature. Oh, wait. Looks like they're going to actually contest for Scuttlecrab. Kane is jumping on.
Oh, is Kane going to get the gank?
He has red buff. He's able to chase because red buff actually slows you. Yep, and King got a juicy kill. And he gets his Scuttle as well. What Scuttle actually does, it actually provides a little bit of vision for you when you kill it. And a lot.
Nice.
Nice little bit of gold. It doesn't provide much experience, though. People normally get it for the vision it gets here, and you get movement speed from there as well. That's the nice part. And it looks like they have a little vision here. So Nasus is not exactly worried about ganks, most likely, since he's sitting as tower the entire time. He just has to stack. He doesn't need to win lane super hard. He just needs to get his stacks. And once he gets his stacks, he will be able to do well.
And it looks like we've got an Infernal as our first dragon coming down. So those Infernal Dragons are actually going to...
It's actually, fun fact, if you look at the symbol right here, let me bring it up over here. If you actually look at the symbol, that actually means Cloud Drake.
Cloud Drake?
Yeah, they added that little symbol there so you can see ahead of time what kind of dragon's coming. You can see the little symbol on the map.
But then why in the top right corner, top left corner there, are we seeing... Oh, that must be the Sky Dragon's thing. It looks like an Infernal Dragon. It looks like a Fire Dragon to me.
Yeah, it's a little tricky. Oh, it looks like Ashe got caught by Thresh. There we go. If Kate was also there, Thresh could have probably pulled Ashe into a trap. Since Kate is level 3, she has all of her abilities, but she is really behind. And for right now, the bot lane that got all the kills, it's Ashe and Lux. And Lux is actually the one that's getting all the kills. And we got some action in the bot lane. Oh, they jumped on Lux again, but it looks like she's able to flash and get away. But Thresh pulled her in, and are they able to kill? Their abilities are on cooldown, but Jax still gets the kill. And Kane, he does not care. He wants to fight this. He wants to avenge his teammate, and he has his ult. That was his ult right there. And he's most likely... Oh, but Jax used the Counter-Strike. No, he avoided it. So Jax might be dead here because he has the rip-up. And there we go. Kane got a double kill. He avenged his teammate. What happened there was Kane used his ultimate. Since he's level 6, every champion gets an ultimate of some kind. For him, whenever he damages an enemy unit, he gets the ability to go inside their body. And poor Kate having a real rough time in this lane.
And again, Ashe can be a very deadly champion.
Yeah, once she starts to hit you with her attacks, you're having a real hard time moving, since she can constantly slow you with her basic attacks. That's her passive. But everyone's still giving it their best. But what Kane did still with his ultimate, every time he hits someone with an ability, he can use his R to go inside them and attack them with a special attack. He basically becomes invulnerable, almost like Zhonya's, but he still does damage. And we got some action in the top lane. Olaf is fighting off the Nasus, but he looks like he just was a little bit too overconfident and is still staying. He can escape, though, because his Q does slow Nasus. Can he win this fight, though?
I don't think so. I think he's got two. Nasus got two health.
Yeah, plus 12 right there for Nasus. That's great for him.
Now, when you say Nasus getting stacks, for those of us who might not know, what does that mean?
What that means is when he uses his Q, and especially when he kills a minion like this cannon minion right here, he gains 12 stacks, which is basically 12 extra damage. For a normal minion, I think it's 6. Exactly.
So when he's getting that last hit to get that kill, he gets an extra buff. And then when he gets extras for killing champions...
Yeah, it's as much as a cannon minion, basically.
So Nasus then becomes even more powerful without actually getting any items.
He is basically an infinite stacking champion. He can get stronger without needing items, and that's what makes him a really dangerous opponent, because he can build tanky, and his Q can still do a lot of damage. And we have a little bit of action in the mid lane. It seems like they're mostly playing passive, trying to feel each other out. It looks like they're mostly just trying to farm, and none of the junglers can really set up anything. But as I say that, Kayn is coming in to try and take down Zarya, but she uses her ult to try and escape, but Kayn follows up with her ult and is able to get a nice juicy kill, and is able to chase Jax off. Oh, and Xeroth is using his ultimate to try and finish off the Jax. Can he do it? And he finishes him off. Good one on Xeroth to try and hit those ultimates. What Xeroth did, he actually became a little artillery unit. What that means is he's able to fire off three shots, and it's a massive range. You think Lux range is really good. This one covers almost the entire map, basically. It's a giant circle of where it covers. And right now, what they're getting now is platings off of this. They each one have like these little bars. Once these get exited out, they gain extra gold.
Huh. And that is definitely something that's been implemented within the last couple of years, because I don't remember that being a thing.
It makes getting towers early a bit more value, because you gain extra gold for pretty much breaking it. And Jax is getting a little bit comboed by Xeroth and his abilities, because for Xeroth, he's able to stand in the back and just absolutely pelt you with abilities. Oh, we got some action in the bot lane. We got Ashe is a little bit low, and Thresh is a little bit low, but Kayn is still autoing, trying to finish off these. Oh, but she used her passive on the minion and wasn't able to finish off Ashe. But, he got him.
Very close.
Yeah, Thresh did his best, but wasn't able to finish it. And we got some action over here, it looks like. Kayn is feeling quite confident, but he's gonna back off for now since his lane is. Oh, but Jax finished off that kill real quick. Oh, but Kayn got hit by the Lux ult.
There it is.
We were talking about that. Oh, but she was able to CC. Will he make it? He does have his gap closer.
I don't think Lux is gonna get it out of this one.
The
tower.
Yeah, but Kayn. Kayn is coming in to finish this. You were trying to attack my friend, not today.
I was thinking that Jax might have gotten out of that one, but then Kayn just decided to come down the river. Neither team going for that Skybreaker, though.
Yeah, none of them are exactly focusing on the objectives. It seems like they're mostly focusing on lane pressure, at least for the junglers. And what Team Pandas should be doing right now is putting up vision. They don't have nearly enough. Oh, and we just missed the kill in bot mid lane. We got Xeroth soul killing Ahri, the Ninetales Fox. Impressive as that is, now they have mid pressure, so they could go for Skytrack, and it looks like they might be setting up for it. They're getting the Scuttle Crab. Bot has priority because they're pushing up the enemy bot lane up.
So if it were me and I was playing this, I would try to rally my team at the bot lane, take out the bot lane team, and then go for the tower, and then after pushing that tower, hit that Sky Dragon.
Oh, and they got, let's see what happens here. Lux got her all off, we got Xeroth here. That was a good hook by Thresh, but the team.
Oh, there we go. Too much pressure.
Yeah, this. Oh, and as we can see here, Kayn actually went one of his forms. He actually went blue form, which is the assassin form. It looks like since he got a lot of kills, he has around. He has the most kills on his team. He has 6 kills. And he's able to get all of his items. Not all of his items, but he's able to get a majority of his items so he can burst down the entire enemy
team. And they're
team.
Just going to take this Sky Dragon uncontested.
Yep. And now what Sky Dragon actually does, it gives you movement speed across the map. It can help you move quicker, and that's great for Kayn. And let's see if he can one-shot her. He has his ult. In his blue form, his ult actually does even more damage than before.
And there he goes.
And Olaf is being chased, but he looks like he's able to get away. Jax trying to cut him off, it looks like. But Olaf looks like he wants to go for a fight. Can he do it? Oh, it looks like he can't. Yep, he's just strong enough to finish off the Jax.
Oof, there we go. I thought Jax might have had that one, but it seems like there's been way too much actually going on. Seems like with 22 kills to 6, I've got a feeling that we've got the match kind of decided at this point.
Yep, LND definitely has a really nice lead. But if they're not careful and they let Nasus stack, he could potentially carry this team. Because, like I said, their bot lane was most likely going to be their weak point for Team Pandas. Their bot lane was definitely going to be a weak point, so they had to come up with a way to make up for that little bit of weakness. But Jax was able to help other lanes. So he was able to do his job, but their bot lane just could not handle with the pressure against Ashe and Lux with their CC and abilities.
So this is going to be an uphill battle now because the mid lane tower is gone. So that opens up a lot of space for Team Pandas to roam around in LNG's area.
Yeah, Pandas need to work on their vision because they need to know where the jungler is. Because the jungler, oh, and speaking about the jungler, he just killed the top lane over there.
That's a big kill because Nasus was having tons of stacks. And there goes another
Oh, and it looks
tower.
Like there's a big battle in mid lane. Xeralt is getting jumped by everyone. And he got hit by the Thresh Hook. And Ahri's over there to assist. And it was a 4v1. Xeralt stood no chance against the
combined. Yeah, you can't win in a 4v1 unless you're like super late game and have a bajillion stacks.
Yeah, even then, it would still be very difficult because each champion provides different coverage they can do. It looks like Team L&D are working on this
Rift Herald.
They actually updated Rift Herald from last time you played. Her name is actually now Shelly.
Oh, okay. I did not know. I just thought it was the Rift Herald.
Yep, she likes long walks on the Rift and taking down towers. She actually has a lot of new fun abilities to where she can take down towers really quickly. So that's why you want to prioritize getting her now. And it looks like Ahri just did not see Kayn, and then she got eliminated. That's the problem. No one has vision on this map. They need to be able to find out where Kayn is, because he has so much pressure on this map. Because since he's blue Kayn and now has Cloud Drake, he can move anywhere on this map and be able to eliminate everyone. Right now he's going bot, and they don't know he's coming. So he could potentially get a free triple kill down there. With how strong he is, he can mostly do this.
And how much health the other team does not have at this point.
Yeah, it looks like Kayn's the first one to go, and then Thresh is the next one to go. Jax is trying to stop him, but doesn't matter. That's a triple kill for Kayn.
Yep.
A free easy kill since they were all pretty low and Kate was the first one to get bursted down. They did not stand a chance there.
Yeah, and that's vision being the key is what you're going to see other teams utilizing here in the future. I think they're going to be learning from this first game.
Yeah, but like I said before, the first game, it's probably they're all nervous. They're trying to learn what they want to do. They're still getting used to the new computers that they're playing with. It's the first game's definitely the test.
Yep, the Rift Herald has been summoned and coming up bot lane, so that's going to be a priority for LNG to be able to take care of, because that's going to take out potentially two of their towers.
And here's Shelly going in for her headbutt. Boom! You can see all that damage it does to the tower.
Cheese and crackers. That's like more, just about half of the tower was gone in one shot.
Now, I wouldn't say that's probably the best use for Shelly, because if you want to prioritize her use, oh wait, hold on. Oh, let me hold that thought, as it looks like Olaf is starting to get chased by the entire enemy red team.
Oh,
but he used Unstoppable.
Gotta watch
that's
out for
his
Kayn.
Ultimate.
He's coming in on the side.
Yep, he's coming around the side. But what Olaf just did was activate his ultimate. It's basically Unstoppable. Oh, and Kayn's
just
destroying
Kayn
him over
here. Comes through
and
gets...
Oh wait, could he die though? Because he's pretty low. Does he have his ult? But nope. Olaf came in for the assistance.
Boom, boom.
And he got a quadra kill. If he's able to... Oh, wait, they're all dead, though. What he could have done... Oh, wait, is he dead by the tower? Oh, that's embarrassing.
Nope, and that's an ace, though.
Oh, that's embarrassing. Just after getting a quadra kill as well, dying to a tower.
Yeah, there's worse ways to go. You know, sometimes you just got to dive on that tower, but that does give the enemy team an extra 700 gold.
Yeah, because there's now bounties in this game. Especially, that was a really bad bounty he gave. If I remember correctly, he gave a 700 gold bounty to their Jax, who is a late game champ.
Ooh, that's
so
dangerous.
If they're not careful, Jax and Nasus could potentially come back from this, even though it's very unlikely since they are 12k gold down.
12k gold and 22 kills in the hole right now.
Yeah, and they don't
and
have
their
any
turret,
towers.
Their tower their turret advantage is huge right now. They have not taken out any of the Pandas towers. And we have another dragon coming in 2 seconds here.
And it looks like this tower is actually an infernal. So now we do get some infernal action.
So you got to wonder if blue team, it looks like Olaf and Kayn are
going
right
for
it.
Because right now, they have no contest. They could take this without any worry. Unless the entire red team comes right now, they're most likely, oh wait, Olaf's looking like he's going to go meet them. Kayn's going to solo the dragon himself, which he's doing fairly well since he's really strong. Because like I said, his Q does bonus to monsters, which includes dragons, if I do believe so.
And there we go. Dragon down. That increases damage
overall.
Output.
Yeah, for infernals, it increases damage to enemy champions. So right now, not only are they super head, but now with that dragon, they do even more damage.
So this is where they got to be very careful.
Oh, wait, Olaf is going into 1v3. He used Unstoppable. What's great about Unstoppable is none of the CC affects him during that time, and he gains extra AD.
And
so
that's triple kill right there.
Yeah, he was able to ignore everyone's CC. And that's a quadra kill. That's a quadra kill. But look, that Kayn took his Penta away from him.
Aw, come on, Kayn. Let him get the Penta.
Yeah, Kayn, he's working so hard for that.
At least they got the ace, though. And the ace means that the entire enemy team is down for at least 30 seconds.
And now we got to see who else is going to get a quadra kill in this team. Will it be Deluxe, Xeralt, maybe the Ashe?
I don't think anybody else is really going to need to get that quadra kill. I think that might have been the team fight that put the nail in the coffin.
Yeah, it looks like they're just about to just push it up and try to end this game. And Red Team's going to do their darnest to try and hold them off, but it seems very unlikely of what they're going to be able to try. Because as you can see by their levels as well, Kane is level 13, and poor Kate is only level 8. She is not able to hold it off by herself. They have Ahri, who's able to do some wave clear through Q, which goes through minions and comes back. But just by herself, she's not able to clear all these minions, and the champions are coming. Xerath is going for the ult. He's going for a very... Oh, but it doesn't matter. He has a very... Oh, but he still gets taken down. They got two.
Yeah, and that's going to be a GG right there.
Yeah, they can end it right now if they wish. But it looks like Kane, just wants to play a little bit more. He's leaving. He's not showing mercy anymore. He wants to play a little bit more. They could end it right now, and Olaf is now dying to Thresh. I don't know what happened there. But he says it's worth in chat, so it must have been worth, apparently. Must have been worth over 700 gold on his bounty. But either way, they only have four towers left. I forgot how to count.
It's okay. Counting can be hard from time to time.
Yeah. And we got here. Kane is very confident. He's not worried too much about this Jax. And Jax is doing his darnest to try to keep him off the inhib. And since they destroyed the inhib, the
center lane's going to have some super minions coming in.
Yeah, they're very tough to deal with. They're already having a hard time trying to stop these minions. Now they got supers to have to deal with. And right now, they could probably get ready for Baron in 50 seconds. What Baron does is actually amplify your minions, making them even stronger. So supers are already strong enough as is. So with this, they could even make the supers even stronger and even more durable. And they could absolutely destroy the remaining towers.
Or they could just go for the execution.
They could. It depends on what they want to do right now. Because who knows, they might accidentally go into a really bad team fight, and Team Pandas are just able to stop this. But
Kane
it
coming
seems
in.
Very unlikely. Kane is just destroying them since he is just so far ahead. He's got a triple KO. He might go for another quadra. But Ahri uses her ult to escape. She has three charges on that, so she's able to move really quickly across the map. So that's a great escape opportunity for her.
And there's the towers going to be going down.
Yeah, it looks like this is the ending for this game. Because we can see on the screen right now the players are now finished. So with our little two-minute delay, we're going to just be able to watch the destruction of the rest of this. The poor towers. Is Ahri going to be able to make a final stand trying to against all these? The Olaf? She's trying her best, but will Olaf be able to kill her? Ah, nope, she's safe in her fountain. Oh, wait, is she? Nope, yep, she's barely safe. And now they just need to be able to destroy their Nexus.
And that is a good game. Well played.
Yep, it was a well-fought battle. And Ash getting a few final kills. We have team
so that's
going to
be the blue team. So.
And it looks like they're going to take this to game two. The first game going to Team L&D. It was a well-fought game by them. Now, what I really want to point out is what I like to say their strongest teammate on their team was their top lane and their jungle, and they were able to play off those two very well. Kane was able to go all over the map and be able to destroy the enemy team once he got so far ahead. That was very important for them.
All right, so that's going to be it for the first match. We'll be right back after a short break with the second match.
This is Southwestern's Dental Assisting Program. In just one short year, you could be a dental assistant. Sign up now for your 1 year dental assisting certification. We'll be right back.
Tokyo Bistro, a blend of traditional and modern Japanese cuisine featuring fresh local seafood, seasonal produce, and unique wine and sake selections. Fresh, healthy, and delicious. It's truly a unique dining experience on Oregon's South Coast. Visit Tokyo Bistro.
For three! Rebound by Pate Crispin. He's going to put it back. And
oh,
hits!
He got it!
The Lakers hit a three!
Welcome back again. He's a part on the Eastlock Lakers.
Can't get the shot to go, and the Lakers win the ball game.
No!
Lakers win! Lakers win! Lakers win in overtime!
108-106!
Whatever your dream, just keep chasing it. In the all-new Honda CR-V. With available features like hands-free access power tailgate, turbocharged engine, and a sharper, more stylish interior. CR-V, the best-selling SUV in America. From Honda.
2v5, let's do this.
My name is Warrant Officer Candidate Brandon Morey, and I am a mechanic in the Pennsylvania Army National Guard. I work on Strikers, Humvees, 5-tons, work on the vehicles, fix the vehicles, get them back in the fight. The favorite thing about being a 91 Bravo is in the event that I would have to move on from the military, I would have a good skill set to help me along and utilize in the civilian sector.
HondaCertified.com, the easy way to search from thousands of vehicles.
Congratulations, you just got accepted into college. Now, how do you pay for it? Fortunately, there are several options out there to consider. Follow this simple step-by-step guide as you figure out how to pay for college. Step 1, fill out your FAFSA? Free Application for Federal Student Aid, FAFSA. Your FAFSA will determine if you qualify for financial aid, including grants, some scholarships, work study, and federal student loans. The good news is most people qualify for some financial aid, which is why this is the most important step in figuring out how to pay for college. Step 2, figure out how much you may need to borrow by weighing your college costs versus your contributions, including any grants or scholarships. Some easy arithmetic will make your math teachers proud. Let's say your college of choice costs $30,000 a year after factoring in tuition, housing, books, lab fees, and a laptop. Now, let's pretend that the money...
Oh, I'm banning this one.
Everybody ready?
And we're back.
Yep, we got the players back into the game, got all set up, and they're already back to the banning phase.
So, was that Draven once again being banned?
No, that was his older brother Darius being banned once again, and it looks like they're having the same bans as last time.
Draven again, so same bans so far, just a different order.
what they really need to focus on is what they were worried about last game. It seems like they're just only banning, because Team L&D looks like they didn't need to worry too much, so they're going to keep their safe bans. But right now, Team Pandas are... I'm kind of questioning why they're not banning the Kane already after the devastation.
Oh, I would have banned Kane and Olaf would have been banned for me at that point.
Oh, they banned the Nasus. They didn't like the Nasus, that was for sure.
I mean, I disliked the Kane more than I disliked the Nasus.
Yeah. Oh, there's the Kane ban.
There we go. That's what I've been waiting to see.
Now we'll see what their jungler can do. And from what I know of from his scrims, he does have a lot of junglers he can't play, including Sylas, who they did ban. So who knows who he might ban. Maybe he'll pull out the Talon jungle or something. From what I know about this player, he does have a very unconventional jungle pick. So he's not too worried from whenever his favorites get banned. He definitely play whatever he wants.
That is understandable. Like, there's a lot of people that can play different jungles. And that's what you want in a jungle player. So it looks like Wukong.
Wukong. Now I'm excited. I know this guy, and I know his Wukong, and his Wukong is definitely going to be spicy in this game.
We got Shyvana.
Shyvana is a very interesting jungler. She has a very powerful early game, and that's probably what they need right now. They need a stronger early game to be able to dominate this lane. And Karthus, who is also has a very powerful ult. So right now, they're changing up their lineup, trying to find a different style to work. What Shyvana actually can do, she actually does bonus damage to dragons. So right now, they could probably get a stronger objective control and try to get control over that if they're able to work on for their lane.
Looks like the Bandit Panda's picking Ashe.
Ashe worked last time. She still has that powerful global ult and was working well in the bot lane. But we'll see top lane pick. Is he going to pick that famous Olaf of his again? Oh, he's going to actually go with the Yasuo.
Ooh,
interesting.
Changing it up.
One of my actually favorite champions is Yasuo. He's a very meme-y champion. People, you know, the spammy Mastery 7, 0 and 12 kind of champion. But we'll see if this top lane can play a nice Yasuo, because Jax... Yasuo versus Jax is not a very... Oh, wait, they're changing up for Yi, maybe.
Oh, Master Yi. They're just hovering over him. Yeah, they haven't picked yet.
Trying to make me excited over
Jax
here.
Jax is getting locked in.
Because Yasuo and Jax don't mix well together. Because Yasuo... Jax can block his autos, basically, with his Counter-Strike. Because that's what Counter-Strike does. He twirls his little staff above his head to block all auto attacks, which is very devastating towards ADCs. So Ashe will barely be able to do anything. But abilities can't get through, so mages can crush Jax if they're able to get their abilities.
Yep, looks like Caitlyn got picked, and then also Lux getting locked in as well. And we're just hovering over.
So it seems like very little changes so far. It seems like they're still going with their comfort picks. And the jungler was still able to get one of his favorites, so they weren't able to ban everything out. And it seems like for Team Pandas, they were able to change up their lineup a lot more than what Team Legends Never Die could do.
Yep, and it looks like we're locking in that Sona as our final support champion.
Yeah, Sona is a very powerful support champion. She can give her ADC lots of buffs.
And as you're looking, it looks like the skills that everybody's picked, everybody but Sona has picked Flash.
Yeah, because this team accepts all people with all sorts of skill sets. So Sona is the most newest member on their team because she is not high enough level to have Flash that everyone does have. So it's unfortunate for her, but she does get to have Ghost, which increases her movement speed greatly.
Well, that's understandable, but not being able to have that Flash to be able to get away quickly, that's going to be a challenge for Sona.
Yeah, especially it's bad for Sona, because Sona is extremely squishy.
So now we've got the spectator delay going on, so we're about 2.5 minutes behind what actual gameplay is.
But we can still give just as good gameplay.
So that's a Riot-specific thing. That is not something that, you know, we do here. I wish that we had it, like, one-to-one, ready, go.
Yes. But unfortunately, we got to have the spectator delay for now until we can probably fix this issue for next time.
Until, you know, Riot officially says, yes, this is a thing. It's a Riot official game, so.
That would be nice. But what we do need to know is that for Karthus, how much do you know about Karthus, actually?
You know, I haven't played much Karthus. If I remember right, his ultimate is a targeted beam that goes down on each of the opposing champions.
Yeah, it's something you can't avoid unless you can go invulnerable, basically. It's very nice. Karthus is a pretty powerful laner in his own right. His Q actually does devastating damage. Oh, looks like we're able to get the inside info.
So it looks like we're taking some views from what is actually going on currently.
These are the players' perspectives that you're seeing right now.
So you're not seeing the Game Master's perspective because we get to stick on spectator mode.
Yeah, this is Team L&D, what they're seeing right now. As you can see, the entire other map for red side is completely covered by what we like to call the fog of war. They can only see it if they apply enough vision, be it with wards or with their own champion's eyesight.
And they're going to be going for red buff.
Yeah, they're leashing for the Wukong. So once they do that, what leashing actually means is basically they assist, because level 1, it's fairly difficult to take down some of those buffs. And we have Yasuo in the top lane. He's able to... It's actually a Shyvana top lane, actually.
Oh, I thought Shyvana might be in the jungle.
Yes, that's what I was thinking as well. But it seems like with her in top lane, she does still have a powerful early game, but I'm not sure if she will be able to be as devastating as she could be in the jungle.
Yeah, it looks like bot lane's going to be going with, you know, the Ashe-Lux combo that was going very well.
And fun fact, they actually switched up their players for the Panda. On the Panda team, they actually switched up their ADC. The ADC that was last game is actually the Sona for this game. So that's an interesting fact. Yeah, we'll see if that switch up actually works. And we got some action in the top lane.
Nah, Yasuo's not going to go for that. He's too weak on tower right now.
Yeah, you definitely do not want to early dive towers, especially at level 2, because tower will absolutely destroy your health bar. But he's in a safe range right now to fight, but Shyvana's pretty confident because she has the minions on her side to be able to fight.
So we're going to be going back to the spectator delay.
So we'll be able to control the map ourselves.
What the map is going, and you're going to be able to see everything that's going on. So you will have a little bit of a delay, but that's okay.
Jax is actually ganking top. We'll see how this goes.
No, it's not going to go.
And we see
Yasuo saw him coming.
He's not Master 7, so I'm not impressed.
So
yeah, we're loading
right
up
now,
right now on
loading.
Our side.
And we're going to be there soon. It looks like Yasuo is being careful right now.
And I'm actually curious what's going on in the mid lane. Because we have Xeroth versus Karthus. Xeroth is able to fight Karthus on an even standpoint. But if Xeroth is not careful, because if Karthus is able to hit just Xeroth, not including the minions, he's able to do bonus damage. Because that's just for a single target. That's what his ability is very specialized in, is taking out single targets fairly effectively. And we are now loaded up on our side. So now we can show you the perspectives of everyone on the team.
Yep, and this is what everybody's going to be seeing as they drop into the match. So it is about 2-3 minutes behind. So what they're actually doing up on stage right now is different from what you're seeing.
Which is not too much. We can still be able to give you the insight of what everyone's going to be able to do. So we actually see what the jungle paths everyone's going to be taking as well. Because it seems like the mid lane and the jungle actually switch positions from what you can tell. Because Jax is in the mid lane position and we got Shyvana in the jungle position. So
it
seems
like we're going to be having a Jax jungle.
Yeah. He was a jungle last time and he was able to be effective somewhat. He just could not handle the Kayn though. So what I'm hoping they'll be able to work on is trying to be effectively using their vision, which is basically trying to cover up these fog of wars to see where Wukong is on the map. Because if Wukong is able, because he has the ability to basically go invisible for a short time, that's his W. He leaves behind a clone and goes invisible to move forward. That can stop vision detection for a little bit, but if they see him ahead of time and he just suddenly stops moving, they know he's about to come for them. So they need to work on that vision if they want to have a chance against the Wukong. Because right now, he's just going to be looking for ganks and he's going to be looking the carrier for what he did last time. If they're not careful, which I'm sure they'll learn from last time and be able to fix what mistakes they made. They're going to tweak their play styles to be able to fit what they'll need. And then we got the blue buff being leashed for Jax by their lovely bot lane. And with that, with the Kate, actually, fun fact about Kate's passive, if she auto-attacks enough, she actually has an empowered attack. So that's probably what you just saw right now.
Yeah, and what you gotta be thinking of with Sona is she's got three different kind of auras that she gets to put off as well.
Yep, her Q is basically, I don't remember all the names for that, but that's the blue one that you can see right now. That's mostly an offensive one, and it also increases the damage that her Kate will be able to do.
Get him. Nice.
Oh, what are you doing?
Nice. I'll take that.
And now we can actually see what's going on in mid lane as well. For me to see with Karthus Q right here, he will be able to do bonus damage if he hits just one. As you can see, the little purple marks that come up, that shows he's actually doing bonus damage. And we can't see it now because he's not only hitting one. So if he, that was 110 damage, which is a lot of damage, especially early on, since if we look at the HP right now, Xerath only has around 600 HP. So if he gets hit by only six of those, he's most likely going to be dead. Yeah. So he has to be very careful.
Early game, you have to be very careful. Late game, especially with beefier players, you can be a little bit less careful, especially if, well, maybe not when you're Jax, but when you're Jax, you got to be careful about abilities hitting you.
Yeah, that was the problem here. Jax used his E just way too soon to be able to get an effective gank off. But with that, he was able to get Yasuo. Just like, tell him, just go away. You don't need this farm. All right, guys, they have it warded. And then we got here in bot lane. It looks like they're actually doing a lot better. There's no first blood here already, so it looks like the little switch up they did with the teammates is working to their favor already.
So you just got to hold back a little bit. And it seems like that's the correction that they're making here. They're playing a little bit safer this time around.
Yeah, there's her empowered headshot, is what it's actually called. It's quite effective. It's very nice. It's a very strong passive, especially for when you want to do straight damage. And we're actually curious, where's the Wukong? He is actually invading the enemy team already. He's doing what he did as Kane. He's taking the chickens, and here is a fun strategy he's doing. He's leaving one chicken behind. The reason he does that is because so when it spawns back in, it won't actually spawn back in, because if he killed all those chickens, then it would respawn back in with every of them, with all of them. But since he left only one of them, it won't spawn back in. So what Jax needs to do is spend time going all the way to his chickens just to kill that one, just so it can start the respawn timer.
That's a weird looking chicken.
Yeah, it would make for a delicious chicken nugget, though, that's for sure.
I don't know, it kind of looked like this weird hybrid Mouser from Ninja Turtles, like way back in the day, the little electric Mousers.
I remember those, the little robot dudes.
Yep.
God. Oh, wait, we got some action in the bot lane a little bit. Lux did miss her Q. Oh, wait, Sona's going in, though. She's applying her buffs, trying to do some, but she gets eliminated by the Lux. That's the thing. Sona is not very tanky, so she can't take a lot of harassment. And all they did was harass her, and then she fell in battle. And that gave Lux first blood. We got this in mid lane. We got Jax in mid lane. He's actually collecting this farm for his mid lane since it looks like mid lane was going to miss this. We got top lane still fighting. It's a very... Top lane is going the same way as last time. It's very farm heavy. Shyvana doesn't look like she's able to do anything because her abilities are very based off in jungle. She's very powerful in the jungle to where she could take a jungle creeper very quickly. So that's what we like to call a fast wave clear.
Yep, looks like Jax was just trying to get some vision down to see what was going on with the dragon.
Is Wukong
going to
die to the big raptor? Is it? No, he just makes it. That was pretty risky, though, but now he's really low. If Jax can find him... Oh, wait, they don't know. Wait, they're about to go meet up.
Right into him.
Oh, he's going the other direction. He flashes, and he gets the kill on the Wukong. He didn't know Jax was there.
That's why jungle vision is very important.
Yeah, it looks like Lux is just going to let Jax get that Krux for free. Oh, or not. Oh, wait, no, the bot lane's going to go, and Jax used his E. He doesn't have his Counter-Strike, so they can use the basic attack. He gets rooted by the Lux, hits by the E, and is he? No, wait, she didn't activate her E yet, but doesn't matter. He's still dead. She didn't want to take the kill from the ADC. That's what she was trying to do.
Nah, you got
to
make sure your ADC needs the extra gold more than the support needs the gold.
But the thing about Lux is, she can be very effective even if she gets a lot of kills, because she could still build AP instead of supportive items. She is a very aggressive support, you call it. Quotation support when she takes all your kills.
Yeah, that's the kind of support that you don't necessarily want.
But when it works. And we see the gamer is still working hard, trying to make sure. We can see the Yasuo going up in top lane. He's getting ready for all that.
And you gotta make sure that...
And that's all the players' perspectives, by the way. And we just missed the kill. Oh, well, that's a kill we're gonna be able to see in the future. A Wukong versus Jax, we can be excited for that. Let's see what happens there. And if we look at bot lane, it looks like, here's a problem with Lux's Q. When she uses her Q, it can only pass through two types of objects, including minions. If it goes through two of them, it doesn't continue anymore. But if she uses it correctly, we got a kill here. Looks like he's not level 6, so he can't activate his ult, and they're able to escape thanks to Caitlyn E, which is her net trap, which launches her in the opposite direction where she fires it.
But you got to wonder if they've got, do they have wards down in that, in the river?
And we have a red ward right here that spots Wukong, but they are able to ward that as well. But they don't know that there's a ward in there, so they have to remember that. Oh, and it looks like there's a conflict here, and they're going to be fighting it off. Jax is able to hit the Counter-Strike, but he backed off, and then Wukong was able to use his EQ, and he got his Electrocute proc off. Because you got to remember, each player gets like special runes they can use. For Jax, he has Electrocute and the same Wukong. That means if you get hit by three separate abilities, including basic attacks, and you do it in a quick succession, you actually do a little Thunderbolt down, and you're able to do a lot of damage. Oh, and Lux gets destroyed by the K! It looks like this game's going a lot closer than last time.
Well, that's good. That's the kind of game you like to see. I don't like to see those games where people are just run away with the victory.
Yep, and here's the thing. They worked on their weakness in the bot lane. They were able to switch up the players and switch up different. Because if I look at the Jax was actually the support from last time, if I remember correctly. And they switched up the ADC as well. So they're definitely using different players in different positions. I actually met with the Jax himself, and he says he's a very fluid player. He can play all the lanes. So it looks like he's a little bit more comfortable on jungle than he was on support.
And it looks like Jax is coming down to help out the bottom lane. I wonder if they're going to be pushing on that tower.
Yep, it looks like they're still pushing here. And we got mid lane still being itself. Everyone's still working hard. We actually noticed that LMD is about 2k gold ahead almost. So that's really nice. And we got some action in the bot lane. Kate actually landed a trap. So Ashe got caught in her trap and she was able to do a lot of damage. But Ashe is slowing her constantly. But she gets caught in the trap again and gets hit by a headshot for free damage.
You gotta make sure. That's what Sona was there for, that green being that healing aura.
Yeah, because, oh wait, Wukong is level 6, so he can hit with his whirlwind if he wishes. And he does. He uses his ult. It knocks everyone up, and they take down the Sona because she's still extremely squishy. And it looks like Kate, oh wait. Ashe gets executed, actually.
Yeah, gotta watch out for those turrets.
The turret actually gets the kill, not Caitlyn herself.
Now, when the turret gets the kill, the entire team shares in the gold for that kill.
No one gets the gold. That's the thing. If you get executed, you don't share any gold. You just have that embarrassing death that we all can look at.
Oh, okay. Just making sure.
And we all can laugh at it.
I mean, it's kind of funny.
Yeah, but it's a very valid strategy if you don't want to give a kill over to your opponent, especially if you're like being chased. Like, say for example, you're being chased by the enemy team and you're behind enemy lines, and if they haven't gotten an attack off you, you could suicide over to their nearby towers, and you can get executed without giving any gold, which is a very valid strategy. You just have that. It's just basically adding a point onto your KDA ratio, which is a sacrifice needed to be done sometimes. And we can see, it looks like this is the battle that we saw earlier with Wukong and Jax. Jax is going for a very aggressive play here. Wukong has red buff, but Jax is low on health, so this battle looks like he'll be very close. He can't see Wukong because he's invisible. He's really
That's going to be the end of Jax right there.
It's not going to be very close since he was already half health when that battle started, and Wukong had red buff to apply some on-burn damage, but it looks like that ran out as soon as the fight ended, and Jax gave him blue buff. What blue buff does is give you bonus mana regeneration, which is actually very nice. And we got some chatting over here. Find out. Oh, wait, got hit by the Lux. Oh, that's the combined ult.
Love that Lux ult. It's just the big old cannon.
Yep, that was some pretty juicy damage that they did, and they got knocked out of lane. If they stay in lane, they risk dying. But Sona can heal. She just has to spam her W and heals for as much as she can, so they don't have to worry too much. And Ashe and Lux have blown both their ults, so those have a long cooldown, so they can't just use it again. And Jax is right here, and with those cooldowns down, they can go and he flashes in. He jumps in with his E, and he's able to hit him with his W. Oh wait, his W is just not in range, but he still gets the kill.
That's a good shutdown, so that means he got an extra bounty of 150
and
gold.
And they're already almost full health as well. That's the best thing about Sona. She's able to constantly keep healing you, so even if you get blown up like that, you don't need to worry too much. And it looks like we missed the kill top lane as well. The Yasuo Mastery 6 champion over here got a solo kill on the Shyvana. And that's going to be really nice. He's not actually going to push this lane. What he's probably mostly doing is not pushing the lane so he can keep the tower. He wants to keep the Shyvana in lane mostly so she can miss out on farm. Because at every time this tower kills a minion, that's gold and experience she's not going to get. And it looks like they just got Mountain Dragon all the way over here as well. What Mound Dragon actually does is give you objective control. It lets you do bonus damage, and Jax just got chunked down by the Zoroth, who uses his ult. Can he dodge it? He has one bullet left, and that's all he's able to do.
But so very close.
He flashed in, but he misses his Q. He used a lot of resources trying to get that Jax, but he just wasn't able to do it. And Zeroth actually gets bonus missiles he can use for his ult for every time he levels it up. It has three levels, and it goes by every six levels you can get, so 6, 12, and 18. It's pretty good. And we got over here, we have a live view of what's going on, and it seems like they're pretty close. So it looks like they got lower towers in the bot lane. We got the jungle's perspective right there. As he looks like he's going in. We don't know what happened to them, but let's not worry too much about that.
Looks
and
like Karthus the blue team has summoned down the Rift Herald, which means they're going to be going for some towers.
Yep, they got that down. They kept the Shyvana up in top lane, and so they're able to kill
gank.
Her. Because here's their plan. They wanted to keep the Shyvana in top lane so they get not only a free tower, but a free easy kill thanks to Shelly over here. Because you can see her damage. It literally chunks almost half of its health. So they just need to get low enough to where Shelly can kill it and tank the tower for them. And they got the Jax as well.
Jax was just sticking around trying to take down that Rift Herald
and
stick around
tried
too
to
long.
Off, but he just couldn't do it. And it looks like they're going to be working on bot lane. It's going to be very interesting to see if Kate can hold this. They are low, but Kate is low herself. But she's able to regen her health because I believe she got some lifesteal. She does have Doran's Blade, so she's able to lifesteal on some of these creeps to restore just little its bits of HP so she can stay in lane while trying to gather this CS. But yeah, top lane lost all of its towers almost. It's only have these towers over here. Mid lane and bot lane still have all their turrets so far, but it looks like mid lane's not gonna stay up for long. And turret plating has now fallen, so whatever turret plating that was left on the very beginning turrets, they no longer can get. So they can't get that easy gold value. So, and Jax is going in over here, but gets stopped by the Zeroth E. That's with that.
So
oh wait, Karthus flashed.
So the tower advantage right now, 3-0, as we are on a rampage.
By Zeroth, Karthus flashed in trying to go for the super aggressive play. And from the cheering that we hear right now, it seems like something good very much happened for the end.
I think it was that rampage that we're getting as Yasuo is trying to chase down Jax.
Oh wait, he got all the double knockup.
Boom.
Fun
boom.
Thing about Yasuo.
Double kill right there.
Whenever an opponent gets knocked up by his tornado, or whenever he's in the air, he can press his R button and literally is able to get a very effective ult off where he does a bunch of damage to them and knocks them down into the ground. It's very effective.
Yeah, and Yasuo is going to go for that tower as the minions get targeted first.
Yep, they're still pushing that mid lane in, and it seems like something bad happened for one of the teammates. We don't know which one it was, but this
looks
game...
Looks like bot lane might be having some action going on right now.
Yep, we saw Luxul, and we see Sona. It looks like she's about to fall, and she falls. She's still very squishy, even with all her healing. She cannot out-heal their damage. But we have Kate is still trying to hold it off. Asha taking damage because she used her W. Because if you attack an enemy champion while you're under tower, you gain the aggro of that tower itself over minions.
No! There we go.
And that's the problem. And we still got mid lane pushing in. They're trying to push in these other towers because you could still push in top lane even though there's like only this tower left, but you still get bonus gold for taking out these towers and you gain pressure on the enemy team because they cannot go out that far without the protection of their towers that they can hide under. In this game, it's not as one-sided as it was last time. So with the changes that Pandas made, it did have a great effect going on. So they did make improvements.
Yeah, it looks like we got just under a minute until the next dragon spawns in.
And we'll see what kind of dragon that is. It's going to be another Cloud Drake, our favorite dragon so far. It's the one that has appeared the most so far. And we have the perspective of last time. It looks like Wukong wants to go in because he does have ult. He does have ult he can use. You can see from the perspectives over here, these little symbols do mean they're ults because his Cyclone, it looks like he just went in, used his ult, and was able to knock up a bunch of people. And was that a double
kill?
Yep,
and
that was a double kill.
And it could have been a triple.
Wait, he might. Yep, Wukong is dead there. With the combined efforts of Karthus and Jax, they were able to at least take out the monkey himself. But Yasuo got revenge for him. And so they're going to keep pushing in to try and end this game, it looks like.
I think this game is going to be over.
Yep. It looks like LND is going to take game two this time, and that will be their victory over the Pandas. It was a well-fought battle by the Pandas, but unless they can stop this assault, it's most likely going to be in the victory of LND. So they're still going to be working on this. They still got to be able to get to their tower, so they're still working on it.
It's definitely so. One inhibitor is down, so that's going to... Usually that spells the end of the game once there's inhibitors going down.
But that, it's also a chance for a comeback as well, because supers actually give you a lot of gold. So if they were able to hold off and basically stall for time, they could farm up supers. Got the Yasuo going in pretty hard over here. He's actually going in a 1v5. He's actually fighting almost their entire team by himself, and he's actually doing fairly well. This Yasuo is very fed, and with his E, he's able to go through all the minions and the enemy teams themselves. And that's a quadra kill. Can he go for the Penta? Will he get the Penta, actually? Kate is over here, but is Wukong going to steal it? Will Wukong steals the Penta!
Aw, oh, come on, Wukong. Let him get the Penta.
This is twice. He has now stolen the Penta away from their top lane. And it looks like he does it with vigor and enjoyment.
And that's basically all she rolled.
Yeah, this is the end for the Pandas as LND takes this victory. Now they just have to push in these two towers, and it's basically over. They're just making one last stand, trying to hold off against these guys. Yasuo knocking up two of them, killing two of them, getting stunned at the tower, but it doesn't matter. He's too fed, he's too strong, he's one-shotting everyone. And we got Ashe going to wait. Yasuo actually saved Ashe, but she still died because of the dragon that drops on top of them. They're still trying to end it. They're still trying to defend, but as we see from here, if we skip a little bit forward since the game has ended for the players, It's over.
And that's going to be the game. So we'll be back after a brief break. We're actually going to bring up a new stream for the next match. So we'll be right back after a brief break.